said, relatively informal. Right. Just talking about, obviously, where you're from, your experience, a little bit of experience as governor of Reserve Bank, stint obviously also leader of the National Party, and then, you know, what's going on today, and what's your view on modern day politics and
some international and some national as well.
Right. Yeah. You presumably haven't read my autobiography. No.
No.
No. I'm not surprised at that. Not many people have. Well, it's all quite well, but.
Where can we get? It's obviously still
three years ago. Yeah. I mentioned it only because I divided my life. Do you recall what the Bell X15 is? Probably not.
No.
You're both too young for that.
The
Bell X15 was an experimental aircraft which the American Air Force developed.
Yeah.
And it still holds the record for the fastest manned flight ever. It got to 100 kilometers in altitude, came screaming down at 7,000 kilometers an hour, controlled flight. But it got to that altitude and that velocity because it was dropped from a B-52 bomber at 40,000 feet. And I said, I was dropped at 40,000 feet. Born in New Zealand, all places on this miserable planet to be born, in the mid-20th century, spared war, free education, good healthcare system, parents who structured and loved me and da-da-da-da. What did I do with my launch altitude? And I said, well, trying to be objective, and you can't be objective about your own life, I think I've had four successful flights. Two partially successful flights, and four or five disastrous flights where people on the ground and the aircraft itself got badly damaged. That's my sort of objective assessment of my own life. But I ask only because if you had known about that, I would have answered one way. If you didn't know about that, I would, well, depends on how you ask the questions.
Well, that's exactly what we're here for today.
Right.
Obviously, you're a respected man in New Zealand, your former governor of the Reserve Bank, former national leader, and some would even say a leader of leaders. Now, you just talked about the four highlights. Obviously, hopefully we're going to touch on that today. And obviously we will, but just where did it all start? You said you were born in
Whanganui.
And that's where you grew up and went through all your schooling?
6 years only in Whanganui, but then moved to Christchurch.
Ah.
Most of my upbringing was Christchurch.
What part of Christchurch were you
at? I lived mainly in Kashmir, to some extent in Papua Nui.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
similar, Christchurch boys
and I. Similar. It's my brother. I'm from Papua New Year as well, so
okay.
I know the area reasonably well. From there, did you go on to university in Canterbury?
Yep,
or did you,
yep.
And what was it that you studied there?
I was at Canterbury from 58 to 61. I did my master's degree rather quickly in 61.
Wow.
And then went to the Australian National University in Canberra to PhD.
Okay, and from there, obviously, I'm thinking of the Reserve Bank, but what led up to that? Did you do a few short stints?
I was amazingly lucky. I got accepted into what's called the Unprofessional Program of the World Bank. And 2 years after I was there, Robert McNamara, who of course had been Secretary of Defense in the US, was appointed President of the World Bank. And he asked Lester Pearson, former Prime Minister of Canada, they set up what was known as the Pearson Commission. Now, the members of the commission, seven of them, were sort of big international citizens. But there were 12 staff, three of them from the World Bank Group. I was one of them. So for 12 months, I worked with Lester Pearson and a whole bunch of senior people, giving advice on the role, in my case, the role of private foreign capital in economic development. And because they went very well, the last 2 years, my 5 years based in Washington, I was in McNamara's staff department, which was just a breathtaking experience. Came back to New Zealand in 71, and 10 years chief executive of one of the first foreign affiliated merchant banks, investment banks, in my case with Wells Fargo Bank in California. Contested the East Coast Bay's by-election, lost to Social Credit, contested the general election in 81 in East Coast Bays, was the third highest polling candidate in the country, a National Party candidate, after Muldoon and John Falloon, and lost because the Labour vote collapsed at 12%. Again, held by social credit. At that point, I suddenly found myself without a job and went to work in that building over there, actually now called the Zurich Building. I was chief executive of what was then called the New Zealand Kiwifruit Authority, and I was there for 4.5 years at a time when the kiwifruit was just exploding. Enormous growth in that 4 or 5 year period. Then I was asked to merge the 11 of the 12 trustee savings banks. TSB didn't come in, but the other 11 did.
Yep.
And 6 months down the track, ASB pulled out. And at that point, Trust Bank was never going to fly as an independent bank, and nor was ASB. Because ASB had a strong foothold in Auckland, nothing in the rest of the country. Trust Bank had a strong foothold across the rest of the country, but nothing in Auckland. So Trust Bank got picked up by Westpac, ASB got picked up by the Commonwealth in Australia.
Where was Credit Union in all of this? Was that
Credit unions were quite separate.
Okay.
The trustee savings banks, there were 12 of them in total. As I say, TSB didn't join the group, but the others did. And the thing which triggered it was that the fourth Labor government, which did a whole lot of reforms, as you may recall, many of which, particularly on the tax side, I was very much involved in, said it's inappropriate for the trustee savings banks to have a government guarantee of their deposits, which they did have. So within 3 years' warning, you're going to lose your government guarantee. And the savings banks were all very weak, trustee savings bank very weak, so they had to merge.
Yeah.
But as I say, ASB pulled out, which is another story. The rest, as I say, is history. And I was managing Director Trust Bank, putting these banks together, when I was asked to be governor of the Reserve Bank. So I went from Trust Bank to the Reserve Bank.
After hearing, obviously, the lead up and story to definitely, obviously, a prime and suitable candidate for that role. Now, I just wanted to read out the definition from the Reserve Bank and then get your definition of how you'd explain it to, like, say, a seven-year-old. What it says here is that you manage the monetary policy to maintain price stability, and you promote sound and efficient financial systems, also supply banknotes and coins. Now, obviously the banknotes and coins makes a bit of sense, but to a seven-year-old, how would you actually explain what goes on and what you do?
Am I on camera yet?
Yeah.
Oh, I am on camera
yet.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought we were still doing preparatory.
Oh, no.
Okay. How would I explain it?
Well, for example, to Gary in his truck that doesn't know, he's got a mortgage. What does it actually mean? Or it's probably hard to cover day to day, but in a nutshell, what would you oversee and ensure for New Zealand in that role?
Well, I mean, as you may recall, we had a period in New Zealand of quite high inflation, where prices of everything going up very fast. What caused that? Primarily, it was caused by too much money flowing around the community.
Okay.
And the Reserve Bank tries to restrict the growth of the money supply in such a way as to keep prices rising at a stable rate.
Okay. So, for example, they talk about the OCR.
Mm-hmm.
It's reasonably stable at the moment. Mm-hmm. What does that mean, once again, to someone with a mortgage or without? Does it necessarily mean anything to someone without a mortgage?
Without a mortgage?
Yes.
Well, it doesn't. Yes, it does, because that also determines the interest rates which bank pay on deposit.
Okay.
So whether you're a borrower or a saver, it has a bearing on the interest rate you are paying or getting for your money. But of course, more profoundly, if the OCR is at an appropriate level, prices are reasonably stable on average. Doesn't mean every price is stable, of course. Some prices are still going up, some prices are going down, but on average, prices are reasonably stable if the Reserve Bank is doing its job properly.
I see, okay. So obviously we've got Gary Wheeler in that position now. Was he around...
Graham Wheeler.
Graham Wheeler, sorry. Was he around when you were in that position? Was he even part of the...
Not in the Reserve Bank. He actually was head of the Treasury's Debt Management Office.
Okay.
At a time I was governor. So I knew him somewhat in that role, because he subsequently went to Washington and spent time there. Also with the World Bank, funnily enough.
Yeah, it's interesting how it all intertwines, isn't it? Then after that, went on to National, which obviously was a sort of 5 to 6 year stint?
Not quite five, yeah. Yeah.
And obviously with the Reserve Bank at 14, and then with the six, with what would you say the difference is with going from the Reserve Bank, you were there for quite a long time, then into the National? Was it vastly different?
Profoundly different. In the Reserve Bank, you're very high profile, very visible. People agree or disagree with you, but very few people actually question your integrity,
yeah,
or your parentage, or whatever. In politics, as you know, people either love you or hate you. They may or may not agree with you, but even if they agree with you, they suspect you've got some kind of devious ulterior motive. So being in politics is a very different kind of game. Half the country, at least, regards you as a nasty piece of work.
Well, this was, been watching all sorts of things lately, and it looks, just my opinion, and a few others I talked to, like an impossible job. Even if you win 60%, there's still 40% that don't like you, vice versa. Is it a job that is just basically a never-ending battle? I mean, did you feel that, you know, you could do things right, but it's a hard job for anyone, isn't it?
Oh, it's a very hard job for anybody, you correctly point out. I often ask myself, why did I do it, having left the Reserve Bank, where I was very well paid, to a much lower paid job in Parliament? And I think the answer is fairly simple. In the Reserve Bank, I could make a difference to inflation. I could make a difference to the stability of the banking system. And those are worthwhile things to do, I think important things to do, and I'm very happy with the way that I was able to contribute to that. But it can't fix the education system.
Mm.
It can't fix the social welfare system. It can't accelerate economic growth. The things which need to be done in New Zealand, in those three areas, for example, can't be done from the Reserve Bank.
But that's pretty courageous. I mean, it says a lot about your character, but also your mental fortitude. You'd reached a point where maybe you'd not hit the ceiling, but you know, maybe you wanted more challenges, and that was definitely a big new challenge, wasn't it, going to the...
It certainly was politics. That. Most of my family thought I was absolutely crazy. And at the time soon, I think they might have been right. But having said that, was it successful? No. I didn't ever quite become Prime Minister. I did become Leader of the Opposition remarkably quickly, and I came within a hair's breadth of winning the 2005 election.
Yes.
2005, National got a higher share of the party vote than they had in any election since 1990. When the final votes were counted, 57 members of Parliament wanted Helen Clark to be Prime Minister,
mm-hmm.
57 wanted me to be Prime Minister, and Winston Peters had the other seven.
Okay.
And he was doing his usual, will
Playing.
I, won't I?
That's yeah, right. Okay. Yeah. Well, and just looking at some of the, obviously, the build-up to a lot of elections, the media, they're very interesting in a sense. You know, we're independent, we're free, we kind of just capture what is. The media at times can be your best friend, your enemy, right? I mean, at times with the polling, it looked like you in front and then Labour. Where are they getting their information on, and what are your thoughts on the media in general?
Well, let me talk about New Zealand media only, because I don't know enough about other media to comment on. I think the New Zealand media don't do a bad job. Okay, I find the bias that some of them have is irritating and frustrating.
Yep.
But overall, the journalists that I've met actually do try to do a genuinely objective kind of job. Now, no one can be entirely objective. That you start with your own biases, and some of the media have very clear left-wing or right-wing biases. But I think overall the New Zealand media are not too bad. Sometimes they get it quite wrong. For example, in January 2004, I gave my so-called Ariwa speech. I actually spoke at Ariwa four times, but everyone talks about the Ariwa speech. It was the one I did on the Treaty of Waitangi.
Yeah.
Now, the media overwhelmingly assumed that I had shot myself in the foot. This was a disaster. Brash was proving himself to be racist and a bigot. On the contrary, the public thought this was fantastic. And the National Party went up in the poll, more strongly than any other political party has ever done in New Zealand history. Colmar Brunton, which did the main TV1 poll, was so convinced that the increase couldn't possibly be right, they redid the poll. It was just an enormous jump. And they said there must have been some methodological flaw. So it was a big increase. So that case, the media got it quite wrong.
You're a numbers man, and at times, how do you, political mathematics, there is no proper equation, right? Because that was obviously an example of that. There is no sometimes right or wrong way. Sometimes it can be misconstrued by the media, but then end up in a better position for you.
Well, I mean, as it happened, that was the case then. But, I mean, to be fair, I didn't really expect that. I gave that particular speech because at the time, the Labour government was debating the whole foreshore and seabed issue. So it was a relevant issue to make a speech on. But did I expect it to have that kind of effect? No, I didn't.
Well, I mean, and just looking back on it too, obviously you're there at a time when, I made a bit of a joke with Josh saying John Key looked like a bit of a young boy then, and Bill English still, obviously, he looked like who he is. However, you were there then when they were aspiring, now that John Key has done his dash and moved on and Bill's now in that place. Do you feel John Key did a good job after that 8 years that he was in that position?
No, I don't. I was strongly in favour of John Key being my successor. And indeed, he and I discussed his being my successor several times well ahead of my resignation. And I did resign, by the way. He didn't topple me. He probably would have toppled me if I waited much longer, but he didn't topple me. I stepped down and endorsed John as my successor. I struggled to think of more than a couple of things which he did in 8 years, which a Helen Clark government would not have done. I can think of two things he did,
okay,
which Helen Clark would probably not have done. But by and large, he continued the policies of the Clark-Cullen government. And I think that was disappointing. He promised to make some major changes, for example, on housing.
Yeah.
In 2007, 2008, he made a big speech about the need to fix housing affordability. 8 years later, the housing situation in Auckland is worse.
Exactly.
Markedly worse. So I think he's been disappointing. And actually, I think that Bill will potentially be a better Prime Minister. Now, I toppled Bill as leader in 2003. Mm. I don't regret doing that. But Bill is a person of considerable intellect and courage. It's interesting, for example, on New Zealand Super, whereas John Key said there will be no change in the age of eligibility for New Zealand Super when I'm Prime Minister, Bill has refused to repeat that promise. And I think that was entirely the right thing to do. The age of eligibility for New Zealand Super does have to go up. We're all living longer and longer and longer. And Bill refuses to pretend that that's not the case. And I respect him for that.
Going back to the housing issue, because it's obviously it's ridiculous in Auckland, you know, $1 million homes. We've asked a lot of people just out on the street, you know, high profile people as well, politicians. What could have been done then, like you're saying, could have Key have done to possibly help things now?
I think there were two things. First of all, Bill English, as Minister of Finance, controls what the Productivity Commission studies.
Yep.
The very first study he asked them to do was on the housing affordability issue. And they came up with a very good report, making it clear that the most important single factor driving housing and affordability is the tight constraint on land supply.
Mm-hmm.
We're a country of 4.5 million people, bigger than Great Britain, and you're paying $400,000, $500,000, $600,000 for tiny 1/8 of an acre sections 15 kilometres from the centre of Auckland. I mean, it's absolutely ludicrous. So that's the basic problem. The second issue is the way that infrastructure is funded. At the moment, infrastructure is funded by requiring developers to either put some of it in and then pay development contributions, which get loaded straight onto the price of the section. It's the wrong way of funding infrastructure. Infrastructure should be funded by long-term bonds serviced by the new area developed. you don't expect the rest of the city to pay for that infrastructure. You get the area where it's being developed to pay for the infrastructure, but you spread the cost over 25 or 30 years, not loaded up front on the section price. Because if you're paying $500,000 or $600,000 for a section, you're not going to put a tent on it.
Mm-hmm.
So you put a $500,000 or $600,000 house on it, and you have to 1.2, 1.3 million in no time flat. So restriction on land supply and the way infrastructure is being funded are the two basic core issues.
If it things, you know, you'd won the vote and gone through, would this been something you would have changed or implemented?
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, it's been known to all the key players for years. Bill English too. Bill English and I have both written a preface for what is called the Demographia Survey. You may have seen it came out recently. It was a survey done of urban house prices in about 400 urban areas around the world, particularly in English-speaking countries. That ranks Auckland's the fourth most unaffordable city in this 400 in terms of relationship between the median house price and median household income. I wrote a preface to that study once some years ago. Bill English has also done a preface to that study.
Mm.
He absolutely understands the issue. Now, part of the problem, of course, is that that's primarily an Auckland Council issue, not a central government issue. So government, to have fixed that, would have had to override the Auckland Council and said, look, guys, sorry, you cannot keep continuing with this metropolitan urban limit.
Would that have been a bit of a challenge, though, overriding the Auckland Council?
Wouldn't have been popular with some people, wouldn't have been popular with the Auckland Council, but I mean, who's the government acting for? The current situation where most ordinary wage earners simply have not a dog's chance of buying a house in Auckland is outrageous.
Look, after that speech, I'm wondering why you aren't bloody Prime Minister. And it's interesting to hear it from, you know, someone that's been in that position as to, you know, then and now, because, you know, if some of those policies had been put into place, we might, well, we probably wouldn't be in the situation we are. Are we at a stage now where there's no quick fix? What can we do
now?
Well,
there is a quick fix, but there's no quick fix which is politically feasible. That's the problem. I mean, the quick fix, you could drop the price of urban land in Auckland very fast if you literally freed up the land supply completely and changed the way infrastructure is funded. The problem with that is this would involve a fall in the price of existing homes by 40, 50, 60%. And no government's going to want to do that.
But what would that lead to, too, if some people's housing equity went down like
absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. I mean, people who... I mean, one of the good answers that Bill English gave to a question, I think Q&A or something, The Nation maybe, some months ago, what would be your advice to first-time buyers?
Yeah.
And his answer was, don't buy now.
Usually real estate agents say the other thing, or
that, of
the
course,
other way around.
Their incentive is to make you buy it, and they want the government to provide more money, KiwiSaver money up for housing, etc. But I mean, the reality is house prices will not become more affordable within the next century unless house prices come down. Simple as that. I mean, Nick Smith, when he was Minister of Housing, said his objective was to ensure that house prices in Auckland rose by single-digit rates, not double-digit rates. That's still becoming more unaffordable every year.
True.
Labour has said their objective is to have house prices rising at 2 to 3% a year.
Yeah.
I'm not going to get more affordable at that rate either, because incomes are not rising by that much.
No.
So neither Labour nor National are willing to say house prices have to come down. Ironically, the Greens did say that. They were dumped on for a great height by Andrew Little. Don't say that. Obviously, he doesn't want to tell people who might vote Labour that they're in partnership with a party which wants to bring house prices down. It's a politically tough problem.
You being where you are now, and obviously with the knowledge you have and the experience, because you still speak very passionately about it, do you like sitting back and watching what's unfolding? Does some party you want to go get back in there?
I find it frustrating, but I understand the political difficulty. As I say, no government wants to say we're going to drop house prices by 50%. So had the government acted in 2008 when they first got in, they could have dealt with it by their relatively minor fall in house prices or a stabilisation of house prices. They didn't act on it, and it's now a hell of a political problem.
We're talking about quick fixes, maybe radical ideas. We just had recently on the show Gareth Morgan, You know, obviously you probably know a little bit about him, his background, the economist, trade, etc. He's got some would say radical views.
Mm.
What are your thoughts on him? Have you seen some of his policies?
Yes, I have. I think he is right to be worried about housing affordability and the way housing is currently taxed. His proposal, I think, on the taxation of housing is something economists might like, but we simply ain't going to fly.
Yeah.
When he wants to tax the imputed income,
yes,
of a owner-occupied house. Now, that is something which economists can all understand, but try selling that to the ordinary voter. I own this house, you're going to tax me on this?
Exactly.
It's not going to fly. And, of course, this other area where I disagree with him quite strongly is on the whole treaty issue.
Mm.
I mean, he suggests that the treaty created a partnership between Maori and non-Maori, and he wants to create an upper house half of whose members would be Maori. What?
Mm.
I mean, that is, to me, plain nuts. And it wasn't what the treaty said.
Yeah. Well, this is one of his points, that around the world there is a second house. We are the only nation in the world that doesn't have this second house. So he feels that
I'm the only one. I'm not sure, but certainly you're right. We're a small minority.
According to him.
Okay, maybe you're right.
Possibly. But he said that a lot of reforms, policies, may not be in place now if we had that second house. Now, I didn't know 50% of it was going to be Māori. That wasn't discussed when we sat
down. That's what he said in Ratna the other day.
Yes, that wasn't discussed. So it's hard to answer that one, or even talk about it. But you do agree with some of his policies, apart from the imputative tax or the 1% on the rent as what it might be.
I don't want to say I agree with his policy without talking about particular policies, but I mean, I think he is right to be worried about the effect of the housing situation, absolutely right. He's right to be worried about what the house price escalation has done to wealth distribution in New Zealand, which has become more unequal, primarily because of the housing bubble.
Mm. Well, we met with Jeff Simmons as well, who's running in Mount Eden, and one of the big things that came out of the meeting with him was, it's going to be an absolute disappointing disaster if they don't get through. They need 5%, which is roughly 50,000 bare minimum.
Well, it's more than that.
Well, exactly.
I think, yeah.
Yeah, it's probably
near 100,000.
100,000. Yeah. We were talking the numbers with Gareth, and yeah, it's going to be I'd say it'll be a bit of a struggle to get that 5% threshold, right?
Well, I mean, I was briefly involved also in the ACT Party, as you know, and they haven't been at 5% for quite a considerable time.
Exactly.
And they've been around for a long time.
So how's someone coming out of the middle of nowhere going to do that?
I don't think he will do it. He has the advantage of having a lot of money. And he can therefore, if he's willing to throw money at it, he can certainly get visibility. But as I say, I think a number of his policies wouldn't fly well at all.
Mm.
So I admire him for being committed to making a difference. I think that's admirable. I just don't think he's got a realistic prospect of making the right impact. Incidentally, on upper houses, you're right. We're one of a terribly small minority, perhaps the only country without an upper house. If we'd had an upper house in the 80s, we would almost certainly have never had the fourth Labor government.
Mm.
Well, not in the way that it was. Now, there are people who disagree with me, obviously, but I think the fourth Labor government did extraordinary things for the benefit of this economy. Just to take one example, GST. I happen to chair the committee which designed our GST.
Yeah.
I think it's the best GST in the world, not because I was a great chairman, but because Roger Douglas was the minister willing to convince his own caucus to have a GST of the kind that we've got in New Zealand, with virtually no exemptions. It's regarded internationally as the best GST in the world, along with that in Singapore. The two countries both have a GST which covers virtually everything and is therefore very, very easy to comply with. We would never have had the monetary policy framework, the Reserve Bank framework. Now, that is regarded now internationally as best practice. And inflation targeting, and we were the first country in the world to embark on it, is now almost universally adopted by central banks. The relationship between the government and the central bank, which we pioneered in New Zealand, copied in the UK, copied in Sweden, copied in Australia, copied in Canada, because it resolves the question of who should control it. Governments, elected, or central bank bureaucrats. The Reserve Bank framework here says the government should decide the inflation rate which the central bank should deliver, and that's, I think, entirely appropriate. It's a politically highly relevant question, how fast your money depreciates in value, but the government must make that target public. Having made it public and contracted with the Reserve Bank to deliver it, then the Reserve Bank is held accountable to deliver the target.
So fiscally, do you feel we're in a better place now or worse than when you were with the National Party?
Fiscally, we're not in a bad position right now. Government debt as a share of GDP is not high in New Zealand compared with that in most other countries. It's higher than Australia, but it's lower than the United States, the UK, vastly lower than Japan. It's lower than most Western countries. What I worry about is that the government is making no preparation, even in terms of preparing the public for the fact that something's going to have to change. Because with the aging of the population, government debt will explode on current policies.
In the next 10 to 20 years, won't it?
Or 20 or 30 years. It's not going to happen today or tomorrow, but it's going to happen in due course. And I that's one of the areas where I think John Key has been particularly disappointing. He hasn't prepared the public for the fact that things are going to have to change.
Well, it's so fascinating talking about it today and then obviously getting your views on it. Now, we've talked about, obviously, the Reserve Bank when you were with National, your views on current politicians. What are your thoughts on, briefly, because it's a big subject, what happened in America with Trump? Were you following that? Were you interested when
it
went down?
I was following it closely, and I was intensely interested, and I was appalled by the election of Trump. I think Trump is an unmitigated disaster for the United States and for the world. If he does the things he promised to do during his campaign, it'll be very bad news indeed for the US and for the world. If he doesn't do the thing he promised to do, 60 million Americans are going to be hopping bloody mad.
True.
And even more disillusioned with politics than they were previously. So I think he's a very dangerous man.
Did you find it hard to believe when...
I found it very hard to believe.
Were you flabbergasted, just astounded?
A guy who offends women, Afro-Americans and Hispanics can't possibly win an American election. But he did.
Would you have chosen Hillary? If you had to vote, would Hillary be the candidate
for
you?
Absolutely, no question in my mind. Was she the best possible candidate that Americans could have chosen? Possibly not. But was she better than Trump? Unmistakably, in my view.
I think what it has obviously woken up a lot of people as well, and gotten them interested in politics, whether it be young, old. It certainly was quite surprising for a lot of us too in New Zealand. I was quite blown away by the results.
It was an astonishing result, and I think what we're seeing even now is astonishing day by day. I mean, leave aside the ban on immigrants or refugees from Muslim-majority countries. I mean, even the conversation with Turnbull in Australia, you know, one of America's longest and strongest allies has a phone call with the president where apparently people got angry and hung up the phone. I mean, this is unbelievable stuff.
Obviously, you heard about the news of him and Bill, which went really well, apparently went well, and that's, I guess, good for us in a sense, but you're right in a way that some of the things that he is putting in place would be quite radical. Some would say he's delivering on what he promised and he's doing what he said he would, but you'd say that's probably not for the best.
Absolutely not. I mean, to scrap the TPP, I think, was a bad mistake to start with. Then to sort of call into question the North American Free Trade Deal, NAFTA, is absolute insanity. And then to talk about 45% tariff on imports from China.
Yeah.
I mean, what are you trying to do? Start a trade war or a real war? One or the other. I mean, it just blows my mind that you could be that stupid.
Look, it's going to be interesting how it unfolds. I was talking about earlier, you know, you watch CNN, you watch Fox, both have got obviously conflicting views.
I try not to watch Fox.
Sometimes it's good entertainment, but you're right. It's scary to think of what's going to happen in the future. Obviously, some of the Constitution now has been involved with blocking some of his decision. So it's a bit of a scary situation on the global front, isn't it?
I think it's very scary. I mean, you've got this very unstable situation in the US. You've got a situation in China with a serious debate about whether they can reorient their economy towards a more domestic focus than previously, while not exploding their banking system. I mean, the debt situation in China is quite serious. You've got Japan, where the government is also up to its eyeballs in debt. In fact, it's well over its eyeballs in debt. I mean, Japanese government debt is more than 200% of GDP. Mm-hmm. Ours is about 30%, by contrast. In Europe, you've got populists in France, in the Netherlands, in Germany, in Italy, threatening to pull apart the Eurozone, and indeed the EU itself. But it's a very unstable situation.
So the Brexit, were you for or against? Do you think it's going to be a bit of a downfall? Could it lead to certain things?
Well, it certainly could, but at this point we have no idea what it might lead to. I mean, we don't know what kind of a deal that Britain will be able to do with the EU.
Because that was what I was going to mention. I looked at history. You've lived through Black Monday. You lived through the crash in 2007. You obviously experience when it comes to these and looking at key indicators. You don't want to scaremonger anyone, but do you feel lightly saying, you know, are we leading up to anything like that? I mean, it's really hard to predict, but are some indicators pointing towards that?
I feel very nervous. Very nervous. I mean, it's I feel very nervous. There's just a lot of instability in a lot of major economies.
Yeah, you're right. And I mean, that's the thing. It's cyclical, you know, every 10, 12 years. The last time it was in 2007, you would have been probably quite happy not to be in that position of power then. Where were you when it happened? Did you feel that something was leading up to that with the subprime loans?
I don't want to try and think back at that point. I'm not quite sure what I thought about at the time. I wasn't, as you say, in the Reserve Bank or in Parliament, so I didn't have any involvement in either the action or the reaction to that situation. But I mean, quite apart from the economic situation, you've got a situation now where nuclear proliferation is continuing. In some places, nuclear weapons in the hands of madmen, as in North Korea.
Yes.
You've got the United States and China in some degree of confrontation in the South China Sea. You've got Japan and China, some out of confrontation in the East China Sea, North of the East China Sea. You've got Ukraine, you've got Syria, you've got a lot of situation. And of course, you've got ongoing tension on the India-Pakistan border.
Definitely.
I mean, it's a very scary world.
Gee, when you put it like that, I'm getting a bit nervous. I feel quite happy and safe to be in New Zealand, and likewise, right? We're pretty lucky to be in such a reasonably safe, reasonably stable country.
Yeah.
At this point.
Well, that's one of the reasons I called my autobiography Incredible Luck. Being born in New Zealand, where not only do I have access to education and healthcare and opportunity, but both my sons and my daughter have access to education. And okay, there's ongoing prejudice against women, but compared with the situation in some countries, our daughters have it made. So, fantastic.
Well, that's true. And for those that are watching and have been curious, you know, you've had a very, very good career and respect among your peers within politics and business. What does Dr. Don Brash do now?
Well, I'm one of two spokespeople with a woman called Casey Costello,
yep,
who is of Ngāpuhi and Anglo-Irish ancestry, for what's called Hobson's Pledge.
Okay.
And Hobson, Governor Hobson, of course, said in 1840, as each chief signed the treaty, he said, in Māori, we are now one people. And I believe passionately that New Zealand only has a future, has a harmonious future,
yep,
if we treat everybody equally in terms of political rights, irrespective of when they or their ancestors came to New Zealand. And I think, in fact, most New Zealanders actually agree with that, but we're all scared to say so, because saying so says you're a bloody racist. And I get that kind of abuse from lots of people. I don't think I'm racist.
Oh, definitely not.
But that's the accusation. In arguing for equal political rights, funny enough, some of my Maori friends say, I don't want different constitutional rights. It's patronising to treat me as if I need some kind of special leg up. I'm as good as any other bastard.
Yeah.
It stopped treating me differently.
And they're your own Māori mates that say that, right?
Well, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right. Absolutely. And one in particular feels very strongly indeed about it. He's about 30. He's I'm not quite sure what precise ancestry is, but clearly partly Māori ancestry. And he says, I don't want to be patronised.
Mm.
That's what the current regime does. It says, I've got to be... Māori electorates, as a good example.
Yep.
You know, the Māori electorate set up for very good reason in 1867, because at that point, only men who owned property got a vote. And of course, most Māori property was communally owned. So no Māori got a vote. So they created a situation where all Māori men got a vote, irrespective of whether they owned property.
Yeah.
Now, it wasn't exactly democratic, because they only got to vote in four electorates. But of course, eventually, all men and all women got a vote. So the whole purpose of them was no longer gone. I mean, it's interesting, there are now more than 20 Māori members of Parliament. Only seven elected Māori electorates.
That's an interesting stat, isn't it?
I mean, we vote Māori in on their merit.
Willie Jackson last
night. Well, Winston Peters, Paula Bennett, Simon Bridges, you know, Māori in general electorates.
A good point.
And on the list.
Yeah.
They no longer need special Māori electorates, and yet we treat them as if they sort of need special coddling. I mean, it's patronising.
That's a good point.
Mm. Well, so, that's what I'm currently involved in.
So chairman of Hobson?
One of two spokespeople, okay. Casey Costello, who, as I say, is very proud of the fact she's related to Tidawhai Harawira, is the other spokesperson. And I'm chairman, of course, of one of the Chinese banks.
Interesting, especially with the climate in New Zealand. And how long have you been chairman of that bank for here in Auckland?
Just over 3 years.
Interesting. Well, obviously with your experience, you'd bring a breadth of knowledge to that team and Auckland itself. What's next as well? I heard you talking about kiwi fruit before.
I've had a kiwi fruit orchard, or my family trust has had it for more than 30 years.
Wow.
And that's my main sort of occupation when I'm not sort of behind a desk.
Quite therapeutic?
Absolutely. I don't have the skill or the time to run the orchard completely, but every available moment I get out down there and spray weeds or thin or...
How far is it from Auckland?
Pukekohe.
Oh, okay. That's...
35 minutes.
Yeah.
It's very easy.
So you just go, when you have the time...
Yeah. I went there yesterday, for example. I was down there by 6:45.
That's right.
And worked there till mid-afternoon.
Pretty hot day yesterday, though.
It was hot, that's why I quit at 2:00.
Wow. So obviously it's going to be a busy year with those two positions and then going down to the kiwifruit orchard when you can. Is that what's going to keep you pretty occupied this year? And
largely, although funnily enough, in about 10 days' time, subject to my visa coming through, I'm actually off to a country in the Middle East advising them on GST, value added tax.
Wow.
Because, as I said, the New Zealand value added tax is regarded as a very good one, the GST.
Yep.
I've been asked to go back there and talk about that New Zealand model.
Well, that's certainly something interesting to talk about. What was the name of the book again? Because we really want to put that out to other people that haven't read it. I'll be going and get it myself after. So what was the name of the book?
Incredible Luck.
Incredible Luck.
Mm.
Perfect. Do you have a question there as well, Josh?
Yeah, Don. Just wanted to get you, just touch back on Trump. Could you maybe explain the mindset of a Trump voter? I mean, what caught their eye, you know?
I suspect that Trump appealed to people who were worried about not non-white immigrants, Hispanics. Trump portrayed them as rapists and criminals. He appealed to people who didn't like Afro-Americans. He had people who were quite explicitly white supremacists backing him. There'd be people who were troubled by political correctness, who would like a bloke to be a bloke and grabbing women wherever appealed to them. I mean, he appealed to some of the worst emotions in many people. And to be fair, he also would have appealed to people who are doing it tough. I mean, there's no question that while globalization has benefited huge numbers of people, hundreds of millions of people all over the world, including the US, some people have been adversely affected by it. Jobs have been lost, factories have closed, towns have become ghost towns. And if you're in that situation, you don't want theories about economic trade or international trade. You just want someone who's going to fix it for you. And Trump promised to fix it for them. Now, in my view, he can't. But if you're out of a job and have no prospect of getting a job, or a job of the kind that you used to have, Trump would seem pretty attractive.
And what did you think about the travel ban? You know how he's stopping, there's a 90-day travel ban on 7 countries in the Middle East. Mm-hmm. What are your views? I mean, because, you know, some people see the value in it. I mean, because try and stop extremists from entering into the country.
Well, because the bizarre thing was, he didn't include, for example, Saudi Arabia.
Mm-hmm.
But Saudi Arabia was where most of the 9/11 terrorists came from.
But those 7 countries were identified by the Obama administration as, you know, the Homeland Security had sort of picked them up. So he sort of picked them up from there. But do you think he should have extended it, or?
Well, I mean, I don't doubt that the U.S. and indeed all countries have to watch their borders carefully to avoid people who are terrorists or inclined to terrorism. You don't want too many of those in your country. But to define all Muslims as potentially terrorists is a pretty extreme thing to do. In a sense, you play into their hands. The Islamic extremists say we are in a religious war.
A jihad.
Yeah, jihad, that's right. Trump is almost confirming that for them. I mean, far from making the US more secure, I think he's making it less secure by feeding into the myth that we are in a religious war.
But you know, all around the world, like in Paris and in Brussels, in Florida, they had the gun shooting.
Yep, that's right.
You know, how do you vet these people? How do you?
It's a genuine question. I absolutely agree with that. I'm troubled myself about the extent of support among the Muslim community for Sharia law, for example.
Exactly.
I don't want Sharia law in this country. In fact, in my book, you'll find a few pages on this question. And I think people who come to New Zealand ought to be asked to sign an oath pledging to particular support for particular values. Equality of men and women. Absolutely no support for female genital mutilation. Freedom of religion. Worship God in any way you choose, or not to worship God at all, if that's your preference. That should be fundamental. And I would ask everyone seeking to immigrate to New Zealand to sign that kind of oath.
Would you maybe impose a travel ban on countries that are harboring ISIS members or have quite a lot of extremists in their countries? For New Zealand?
I'd be reluctant to do that personally, but I would certainly want to make sure that people who came from those countries were well and truly vetted. I understand that concern, without doubt.
Because it seemed like Hillary wanted the increase of refugees and she wanted just sort of open borders.
That's certainly the impression she gave, and I think that was unfortunate, because I don't think any country these days can have totally open borders. I don't think that makes sense.
Because there seemed more outrage at the travel ban, but there was not as much outrage when, you know, these countries were getting bombed almost. So, I mean, I can see his point in some way. You have to protect your citizens, right?
You mentioned the word racist before. And I've watched you over the years, and just meeting with you now, it just perplexes me that
on immigration.
You mentioned the word racist earlier.
Yeah,
the label calls that.
Right.
And after speaking with you now, knowing, just seeing you over the years, it must be perplexing how someone would even. Do you say you still get that to this day?
Oh, absolutely.
But I mean, it's clearly not that you're not a.
Well, I don't think I am. Was brought up for 5 years. When I was a teenager, we had a Sri Lankan student living with us for 5 years.
Yeah.
And he became not an Asian student, he became a part of the family.
Yeah.
And he was absolutely part of the family. My second wife was Singaporean Chinese. So I don't think I'm racist, but when we launched Hobson's Pledge, this organization last September, everyone and his dog said, "Oh, Brash is racist again, you know, Ariwa, he's you know, can't bear to be out of the limelight. He wants to be," and racist was the adjective most commonly used.
It just perplexes me.
How do you hold your head up high, you know, like with people just throwing the labels and not having constructive debate, you know? How do you...
Well, I mean, all I can do is reply as vigorously as I can. In fact, I'm giving a speech at Ariwa, at the Ariwa Rotary Club this Tuesday.
Nice, wow, okay.
And which I'm taking this issue to task. I mean, how can you possibly be racist when you say you want no preferences for any race?
Yeah.
And I quote Martin Luther King, you know, I want the U.S. I want my daughters to be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I lived in the U.S. when Martin Luther King was campaigning, and I was there when he was assassinated, not in place he was assassinated, but in the United States at the time. And he's one of my heroes. He said something, I've got a poster on my wall, which says, "Our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter." Fantastic.
It just says a lot about you, though. Like you said, with the Reserve Bank, why you made that leap. You would rather do something and challenge yourself and speak out than just, like you said, be silent, right?
Well, I mean, I am never going to make the National Business Review rich list. I'm not a very wealthy man, but I've got plenty of money, so I'm not going to starve. I'm comfortably off. I've got my own two-bedroom apartment, so I don't need to sort of rush out and make a lot of money. I've got adequate income for my retirement. So I can afford to speak out, and therefore I should.
Totally agree with that. I mean, you've got the kiwifruit, you're off overseas next couple of weeks, couple of months, and then we've got the elections coming up at the end of the year. Any thoughts on, obviously, you sounds like you're a supporter of Bill English. Any thoughts on Andrew Little? Do you think it's going to be relatively contestable, or is it hard to say?
I think it's hard to say. I mean, I've got a lot of respect for Bill in the economic area. I think he's a good Minister of Finance, and I think he's more likely to confront some of the issues which John Key did not confront. Ironically, the person who's talking most sense on treaty issues and on Maori issues is Winston.
Okay.
Winston gave a speech which was overshadowed by what happened at Waitangi Day in Paihia on the Friday before Waitangi Day, in which he talked about the treaty and basically demolished the idea that the treaty created a partnership. He's got a wonderful line in the speech which goes something like, "If nobody in the British Empire was in partnership with Queen Victoria on the day before Waitangi Day, how come all Maori were by the following day?" So on that particular issue, he's actually very good. I don't have a lot of time for his economic policies, but on treaty issues, he's the only political party leader talking sense.
What did Gareth call Peters?
Oh,
he called him the Trump of New Zealand.
And all the aunties love him.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Well,
did you agree with that?
Gareth's Ratner speech, he attacked both Winston and me.
Okay.
Equating us as both racists and basically saying Winston thinks he can't be called racist because he's racist about his own race. it was quite a good line. And you may, if you haven't seen the YouTube of his speech, it's quite good because Gareth's reading the speech and behind the camera there's Ron Mark and
Muscles
laughing their heads off.
I saw that and I thought to myself, a little bit disrespectful. They were just sitting there and Gareth was doing a speech and they were just in their own world.
Well, mind you, what was also noticeable, if you listened carefully to the tape, no one was paying any attention to Gareth at all.
No. I noticed that.
I mean, the people at the Marae were all chatting and talking away.
Yeah.
And poor old Gareth was reading a speech into the microphone, but
no one was there. So were you there for that, or you just watched the replay of that?
Replay. I've been at Ratner a few times, but not currently, of course.
What would you say to any? This is a question I sometimes struggle with, but what would you say to young people aspiring to be politicians? Because it sounds like a damn tough job, one that never quits, you're on call 24/7. What would you say to them?
Oh, it is a damn tough job. And one of the problems is that for most people who go into politics, it's a very disillusioning job. you never get to influence a single policy measure. Your so-called lobby fodder. You're there to vote.
Yeah.
And you're told what to do, and woe betide you if you step out of line. And that's again where I was lucky, because 15 months after I was elected to Parliament, I became a leader.
Mm.
And that is a much more satisfying kind of role. Okay, I didn't get to change any laws. I didn't quite become Prime Minister. But I had a chance at least to have an influence on policy. And that's all you can reasonably expect. An awful lot of people going into politics never get that chance.
Yeah, you were definitely a major ingredient in national success, right? I mean, if
well,
you look at
2005, I think I was an ingredient. I was not the only ingredient. I mean, I think in 2005, one of the things that also happened was that the National Party, and particularly its president, Judy Kirk, understood how MMP works. In 2002, the party did not understand it at all. Even in 2005, I had a prominent National Party person, formerly in government, not now in government, not even then in government, offering to run our marginal seats campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in MMP, marginal seats are basically irrelevant. Winning electorates is totally irrelevant for Labour and National.
Mm-hmm.
Not totally irrelevant, almost totally irrelevant. Yet people, in 2002, National was focused on winning electorates.
Mm-hmm.
We had almost no party vote billboards. And it's the party vote which is all the thing that finally matters.
Yeah.
Judy Kirk had that absolutely understood. And I think a number of people helped a lot. Actually, Stephen Joyce did too. Stephen Joyce was director of the party at that time. So I don't want to claim the whole credit. I think I made a contribution to National's result, but it wasn't the only contribution.
Do you have people come up to you? I'm even thinking this now, thinking, damn, I wish you got in. Like, things might have been a bit different, better. Do you even have people coming up to you and saying that?
I still do have some people who say that, yeah. That which is very nice of them. But who knows? I mean, what I could have done, I don't know. And of course, one of the problems is MMP, because National has, I think, done some silly things in the whole treaty area, but nevertheless, they have depended on the Maori Party on several occasions where they needed those votes.
If, after speaking today, it feels like you're obviously in favour of Bill English. Well, you liked what he did and what he's done. He could be the one to slightly fix things. Yet if it swings in Bill English, Andrew Little's way, that could all get...
That's right.
You know,
that's right.
Thrown in the dustbin.
Yep. I had preferred the government to be led by National than led by Labour. That's partly because I think the Greens are slightly loopy. And Labour clearly can't form a government without the Greens. Probably can't form a government without the Greens and New Zealand First. And not at all sure that a government with Greens and New Zealand First would be terribly stable. The Greens don't much like New Zealand First, and New Zealand First doesn't much like the Greens. So that may or may not be very stable.
Mm.
But I don't think we will see a government after this election without New Zealand First being part of it. I mean, National has got 59 MPs out of 121 now. And that's despite the fact National had one of the most popular prime ministers in New Zealand history. I didn't like him very much in some ways, but that's not the point. He was very, very popular. And still, National doesn't have a majority in Parliament.
Do you think that was part of the key to his success? You mentioned with populist votes. Do you think he got to where he was because he just went with what majority he wanted?
Absolutely. I mean, he was very much driven by what was popular. And some of the things he needed to say, like, for example, the age of eligibility for New Zealand Super has to go up, he didn't want to say. In 2011, he had Labour on his left and ACT on his right, both saying the age of eligibility has to go up gradually. Not now, not tomorrow, or the day after, but eventually.
Yeah.
He still couldn't say it. So he...
Because it was unpopular.
Yeah. I think actually most New Zealanders accept that that will have to happen.
Mm.
And we're better to get plenty of warning about it than it happened suddenly. But I mean, if National can't get more than 59 with John Key as Prime Minister, they'll almost certainly get a few less with Bill.
Definitely.
And now, that puts them in a situation where they will need other partners. You know, will the United Future get back? Marginal. Will ACT get back? Almost certainly, in my view, the whole Epsom at least. Maori Party, I don't know.
It's hard to call, isn't it?
Hard to call. Which means that to form a majority government, they will need Winston.
But will Winston, he's always in this funny position, eh, where he can sort of sit on both sides and play flavour and off. He's a bit of a strategic chessman when it comes to that.
Do you think there's a trend happening? Like, do you think it's going more right-wing now? Just because, you know, in France and in Netherlands and in America, do you feel maybe New Zealand would go a little more right-wing?
Well, I don't classify it as right-wing. I mean, to me, right-wing means someone who believes in smaller government, lower taxes, more responsibility for the person rather than the government, etc. I don't think that's what we saw in the US. I don't think it's what we see in Europe. What we see is people who are populist appealing to people who are worried about immigrants.
Or more nationalism?
Nationalist by all means. Mm. Certainly that's what it reflects. But I think it's nationalist or populist rather than right wing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, ACT would be classified as a right wing party, but even small government. People are not flocking to ACT. I don't call it right wing, I call it populist or nationalist.
Mm. Yeah, what did you think of the recent policy change? Maybe it's just election year, so that's why they brought it on. But the with medical cannabis, they've changed it from. So before a minister had to approve it, but now it's the Ministry of Health.
Mm.
What are your views on that? I mean, what did ACT Party think of that?
I made the mistake when I was ACT Party leader of suggesting it was time to review our cannabis laws. All hell broke out.
Was that a mistake?
Sorry?
How was it a mistake, though?
Well, it was a mistake because the person standing for ACT in Epsom was John Banks. And John had been Minister of Police, and he was strongly opposed to any liberalisation of cannabis laws. So it was unwise. I hadn't discussed it adequately with him.
Okay.
But again, in my biography, I've got a whole chapter on drug policy. I think we're dealing with the wrong way. I in fact, favour liberalising drug policy, not because I think drugs are a good thing, but because I think criminalising is the wrong way of dealing with it.
That's a good point. Why we brought that up with Gareth, stats-wise. We talked about, you know, the Monday after a weekend when people are in the courts or whatnot. A lot of assaults, things happen, misdemeanors, when people have been, you know, under the influence. But medicinal use for marijuana would probably not have the same effect stat-wise. And why should
someone... People under the influence you're talking about are normally under the influence of alcohol.
Yes, that's what I mean. Alcohol.
Alcohol is legal.
Yes.
Is it less harmful than cannabis? I'm not sure. I'm not at all sure. I mean, I think it's fairly clear that cannabis use by teenagers has damaging effect on teenage brains.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That's reasonably clearly established, and I therefore want to keep it out of the hands of teenagers.
Yeah.
I want to keep alcohol out of the hands of teenagers too, quite frankly.
Yeah.
But the evidence that occasional use by adults does serious damage is very slight indeed.
Mm.
So I'm in favour of liberalising drug laws.
Would you go as far as recreational or just medicinal?
No, I'd go as far as recreational.
So you got the libertarian stance.
Yeah, okay. On drugs, yes.
Yeah.
So
I think a lot of people do feel that way, and you know, like you were talking about before, populist votes, etc. But it's more so the populace that are demanding that now, so it could swing that way as well.
Well, it's swinging that way very fast in the US, as you know.
California, Colorado, Washington.
When I made this speech in 2011, I was on John Campbell's program the following night, and TV3 asked people to text and email in their reaction. Now, this totally unscientific kind of way of sampling public opinion.
I can imagine.
But 70-something% of people said, yep, liberalised cannabis.
Wow, and that was big. It's probably changed even
That's
more.
That's 6 years. Yeah, 6 years ago.
How did John Banks react to it? Because I know he's strongly anti.
Oh, John was very unhappy indeed.
Did he have a discussion with you, or?
We had several discussions on it. Yes.
He didn't listen to any of your views. What you said about the libertarian stance.
No, he's convinced that legalisation would be very damaging for society. I'm absolutely persuaded that cannabis use by teenagers does very bad for the teenagers.
Yeah, I agree.
But I don't think that making it a criminal thing is the right way of dealing with it.
Why do you think John Key didn't do it? Because, you know, he's more of a populist. I don't know. How come he didn't?
The people who feel strongly about it will vote on it.
Mm.
People who strongly oppose it will vote on it. I think John Key probably rightly judged that he would lose votes on balance by pushing that line. I'm surprised that ACT doesn't promote it.
No more?
Because it's not part of ACT's policy at all.
Oh, okay.
I suspect David Seymour agrees with legalization, but he's got to win Epsom electorate. And would he hold Epsom electorate if he came out in favour of legalising cannabis? I'm not sure. So it's a tough one for politicians.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, speaking of voting and what, do you think more young people need to vote? But it's about how do we get them to vote? Because I didn't start voting until probably late 20s, mid-20s. 18 to 25, I didn't vote.
There's a fascinating article in this week's Economist arguing for dropping the voting age to 16.
And your thoughts?
I hadn't really thought that was a good idea, but the Economist basically says, look, at 18, people are leaving home, and they really don't want to get involved in anything much other than sort of immediate pressures on their life. At 16, they're still typically at home, and they may be encouraged by their parents to sort of get along and do their civic duty.
Exactly.
And they say, you know, once they start voting, maybe they'll continue in the habit. But as you're right, younger people in all Western countries have a very low rate of voter participation.
Well, also, so you talk about 16, 24, 25, your brain probably hasn't fully developed until maybe early mid-20s.
Yeah, but if you think about it out there. But Serena Williams, right, she's won tennis competitions, right, at the age of 15, 16?
Oh, that's 14. I mean...
There's people that accomplish great things at young ages, you know? I mean, they pay tax. Shouldn't they be allowed to vote?
But you made a good point, though, only for the reason that their parents might influence them as well with their political views, and it might not be the view of the 16-year-old. So, you know, if you're a strong National or Labour supporter, I'd be forcing my kid to probably vote that almost if you're living under my roof. But that's probably not the right way of doing
it. What do you think, Don?
I had not previously thought of lowering the age from 18. But I can see the Economist's got an argument. I find the Economist magazine fantastic. I don't know if you read it, but it covers a whole spectrum of issues internationally and so on. And I read the editorial policy quite carefully. So I'll think about it, yeah.
It would change the strategy of a campaign, definitely, right?
Oh, it would. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, it was
focusing on the high schools.
Yeah, campaign in high schools.
Everything would change. Yeah.
Might get Justin Bieber as president. Prime
Minister. Oh, so what's the plan for the rest of this week? You're just going to be busy with your two jobs, no orchards?
Orchard yesterday, but not this coming week. And my big event this week, as I said earlier, was my speech to the Arriwa Rotary Club on Tuesday.
Bit of nostalgia going back there?
Yes, and it's become associated very much with the treaty issue because of the speech I gave there in 2004.
Mm.
Funny enough, when Gareth gave a speech there last year on his book, Are We There Yet? Talked about it. I got a ring from his PR agent, said, would I like to write a reply? So I thought about it and said, yeah, I would. So they said, at the Uri Rotary Club, Wednesday lunchtime. They meet Tuesday evening. That's Wednesday lunchtime. Anyway, so that must have changed. I get there, and it's not the Arriwa Rotary Club. It's the premises of the Arriwa Rotary Club, which he had hired for the purpose of making the speech. But he used it precisely because the Arriwa Rotary Club has become, since my speech there in 2004, associated with the whole treaty issue. Yeah. So I'm going there tomorrow night, Tuesday night, to...
What time is this?
6 o'clock.
So hopefully there will be some media outlets there or media coverage.
I'm going to advise the media, yeah.
Nice.
Mm. Are you looking forward to it?
Absolutely, yeah.
It's a bit of an emergence of Don Brash.
Would you ever come back into politics?
No. I've done my political dash. in 2006, after the 05 election, I was certainly contemplating running in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
But at that point, I'd have been 68. the media in New Zealand said, 68, too old, too old, too old. I said, wait a minute. In 2008, McCain is running for president of the United States. He will be 72 in 2008. If he can run to be president of the United States at 72, I sure as hell can run for prime minister of New Zealand at 68. Anyway, the media were convinced that 68 would be far too old. So I bowed out. And I don't regret that. I think that was the right thing to do. There are still issues I care about passionately, and housing affordability is one, and the treaty is another.
You also serve as a consultant, right? A senior consultant for, I thought you were advising the GST policies in Barbados?
Bahamas, yeah.
It's quite
a... And again, the funny thing about that was that John Key was at a Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Colombo, and he bumped into the Prime Minister of the Bahamas. I don't know whether John Key volunteered or the guy from Bahamas asked for assistance for putting their GST in. And we agreed, I suspect we got one more vote for our Security Council membership out of it. And I went up there with John Shewan.
Okay.
And it's the most satisfying consulting job I've ever done, because when we got there, they were proposing a 15% GST with exemptions. And we said, look, that's absolutely the wrong way of going. Cut the rate drastically, cut out all the exemptions. That's what they did. We convinced, first of all, the Prime Minister, who was also the Minister of Finance, and he rescheduled the cabinet meeting so we could meet the whole cabinet to persuade them. Because it's tough politically to cut out all exemptions. It's the right thing to do, but it's tough politically.
What about people that say you don't have GST for like fruits and vegetables? Is that the exceptions that you were talking about? Or?
Disaster. People think of GST as a sales tax, and it isn't. Well, it is a sales tax in one sense, but it's easy to say these items are subject to a sales tax and these items are not. That's easy.
Okay.
That's why lots of people say, look, let's exempt fruit and vegetables. But the GST is levied on every stage of production.
Got it. Yep.
So if you're a retailer and you've got some things which are GST exempt, and something that's subject to GST, you can only claim back the GST you have paid in buying your inputs on those things which are GST-able on sale. You can't claim it back for the things which are not GST-able on sale. Now, that's straightforward if you're just selling apples or pears. But what about your electricity bill? You've got to apportion it.
That would be a nightmare.
Your commercial rent. A nightmare.
Your
accounting fees. You've got to apportion all these things. And what Roger Legler said to the committee, which is I was chairman of, I want you to devise the GST which minimizes the compliance costs for small businesses. Because you'd heard horror stories from the UK of small businesses being crucified by the accounting complexity of all these exemptions. Whereas if you have everything in, GST is extremely simple. I mean, I told the story in the Bahamas again and again and again that I do my GST return for my kiwifruit orchard in about 15 minutes every 6 months. And even then, it's by checking every number, it takes me 15 minutes because, you know, pressing the auto sum button on an Excel spreadsheet doesn't take a hell of a long time. So it's extremely simple. But as soon as you start having exemptions, it becomes very much more complex. And it's not just a matter of some things are not charged at the end, some things are. Much more complex than that. And most people who argue for it don't understand that.
Did they concede to your point?
Yeah, they did.
Oh, wow.
No, but after hearing explain that...
Makes sense, right?
That's total sense.
I mean...
Compliance costs.
When John and I got there, the owner of most of the supermarkets in the Bahamas had all his staff wearing no VAT t-shirts. VAT, of course, is what they call their GST, value-added tax. All of their staff in no VAT t-shirts. He's as happy as a sandboy because his compliance costs are very modest.
So did you say you're going to the Middle East to talk about? But they don't have GST.
They do. They don't yet.
So.
But of course, because the oil price has fallen very sharply, the six countries of the Gulf Cooperation Council are all looking to put a GST in.
similar model to New Zealand, or is that
what you're there to talk about? That's the issue to be resolved. I mean, are they going for a straightforward, simple model like New Zealand and Singapore? Singapore's got a similar model, or the complexity of Australia or Canada or Europe, where they've got lots of exemptions. I mean, you may recall the big debate in Australia, I can't recall, chicken was exempt if it was fresh, but taxable if it was cooked or something. You get into all kinds of definitional issues.
Wouldn't it make sense though to implement what you've been behind here though, across, and that's probably what you're trying to do?
That's what I'm going to argue.
And you're a good advocate for it because that's what you implemented here, right?
And that's why the company, accounting practice, which has got the contract to advise them, has me involved, because I've been a politician, I've also been the, and I can explain to politicians and senior bureaucrats this is doable.
Mm.
And it makes it vastly simpler. The other thing I want to persuade them on is don't force these companies to do accrual accounting. Small companies don't have accountants.
Mm.
They have simple shoebox type accounting systems and they work on a cash basis. Well, cash basis is perfectly satisfactory for GST, and that's what I do on my orchard. I mean, as I say, it's extremely simple. No accountants required.
Get rid of regulations and...
Absolutely. Yeah.
So speaking of fruit and vegetables, I always like to ask, you're still sharp as a tack.
Yeah.
I mean, what is it behind that? Obviously, fruit and veggies, you live a healthy lifestyle. What is it?
Well,
what is it about?
Plus McDonald's.
I can't mention that, but do you live a relatively healthy lifestyle and remain so sharp and alert and active?
I'm lucky my parents gave me good genes.
Yeah.
No credit to me. I do eat kiwi fruit. Every day I have a kiwi fruit. There's a funny story in my book. When I was approached to be managing director of the Kiwi Fruit Authority, I was headhunted, and I went to the interview with the chairman at his home in the Bay of Plenty, at the end of which he said, look, stay for dinner, rather than going back to Auckland right now. I said, oh, okay, yeah, I'll do that. So I stayed for dinner, and at the end, after a nice first course, they said, look, we've got kiwi fruit for dessert. This is the last moment to tell them I don't like kiwi fruit. How do I know I don't like kiwi fruit? I never tasted kiwi fruit, but I knew I didn't like it.
Okay.
I had to eat it because I thought the last thing I wanted to do was tell them I didn't like it. I've been eating kiwi fruit every day since. I love kiwi fruit, but I was sort of conservative eater and thought, looks different. Anyway, so kiwi fruit is an extraordinarily nutritious fruit.
Mm.
Of all the fruits available, it's got one of the highest so-called nutritional densities. High in C, high in potassium, high in fiber. I mean, it's just breathtaking fruit. So I do eat kiwi fruit, but other than that, I don't eat terribly healthily.
Not a wine, the odd glass of wine now and then, or a beer?
I don't drink beer, but I do drink a glass of wine when I'm entertaining. I don't drink wine at home.
And any social media aspects, like we've been asking everyone who we talk to, do they get on the Twitter, the Instagram, the Facebook? Are you...
I'm not on Twitter or Instagram. I do have a Facebook account, which I don't use for personal stuff.
Sure.
I don't have photographs of myself at the beach or at the orchard or whatever.
Yeah.
I use it basically
if
I want to make a political statement of some kind.
Sure.
I'm on housing affordability or the treaty or whatever.
And what would that just be under the name Don?
Absolutely. I'm not hiding.
Well, where can people buy some of Dr. Brash's kiwi fruits?
You can't.
Oh.
because Zespri, as you may know, has a complete monopoly of the sale of kiwi fruit outside New Zealand and Australia. So because the vast majority of kiwi fruit is exported outside New Zealand and Australia, you submit all your fruit to Zespri, and the rejects get sold domestically. And I don't have control over where they get sold.
Okay.
How bizarre. Right?
Yeah.
So just
all the stuff we get in shops is the stuff which is not quite good enough for export.
So your stuff goes, we never get to eat it because we'll go overseas.
Yeah.
You should campaign on that as well.
Well, but in fact, I mean, that's the logical thing to do for kiwi fruit growers, because they can get the best possible price overseas. And the New Zealand market simply could not accommodate the total volume of New Zealand production. My first year of Kiwi Fruit Authority, New Zealand was the only country in the world producing kiwi fruit commercially, and we exported 4.6 million trays of kiwifruit, 1982. Wow. And today, New Zealand will export about 135 million trays, and we produce about 15% of the world total.
Wow.
It has absolutely exploded in terms of volume. It's fruit, a wholesaler once told me it's the most successful fruit since the banana in terms of the increase volume.
When I have traveled though, like Japan and whatnot, it just seems like a delicacy. And over here, I'm just like, it's just a kiwi fruit. But overseas, kiwi fruit are quite huge. Like you said, it's exponential, the explosion of them. So, yeah. Well, Dr. John, thank you so much for your time today. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you so much.
Hope you enjoyed.
You're very welcome.
Putting your opinion
I didn't
voice.
Quite understand when you started filming me, so I hope I didn't say anything too inappropriate when we started.
No. More or less started off on the tail of your book, which a lot of our viewers will go and read. I certainly will. Yourself, Josh?
Yeah. Were you in the military, Don? Because you were talking about the plane before.
Say that again.
At the start of your conversation, you mentioned the plane.
Yeah.
Was that real or was
that
metaphor?
Oh, it was real. Okay. I mean, the Bell X-15 was a plane which the American Air Force commissioned in the 60s. To test various alloys because they were worried that their ICBM missiles, their intercontinental ballistic missile, would melt on re-entry to the atmosphere. So testing various alloys, and they used this Bell X-15 to test them. But I only used it because its success depended on its being launched at 40,000 feet. So I was launched 40,000 feet.
But how are you involved with planes, though? How are you involved with these planes?
I wasn't. Oh. I was just saying, I metaphorically speaking.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Being born in New Zealand, being born in the mid 20th century, you think about it. You take it for granted, but you know we can watch Trump's inauguration, and see it as well as the people standing in the Washington Mall. We have FaceTime. We have. I mean, I talk to my friend in Tauranga on FaceTime every day, free, effectively.
Yeah.
Huh? I mean, even 100 years ago, that would have been absolutely unthinkable. We're living in a fantastic time.
It's a good time to be alive, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Fantastic time to be alive, fantastic country to have been brought up in terms of all the opportunities that we've got. I could have been born in plenty of countries where, you know,
you don't even have to be rich to enjoy some of the luxuries of life, right?
Exactly right.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Oh. My father was a Presbyterian clergyman. We sure as hell weren't rich. We used to have meatless days every week.
Yeah.
My mother said it was for our health. I think it was because we couldn't afford meat every day, in retrospect. So I wasn't in any sense born with a silver spoon in my mouth. But still, we had access to good health care, good education. Fantastic.
Look at how far you've come in life. I mean, it's incredible.
Well, that's why I call it incredible luck. And most of it is luck. The first publisher I took it to said, look, we don't like your title. I said, why not? I said, it smacks of your false modesty. I said, that is crap. Yes, I worked like hell. That's no question about that. But hundreds of millions of people work like hell from well before dawn to well after dusk every day of their lives and never have the kind of lucky breaks that I've had.
Oh, it's an incredible tale. I'm amping to read this book now.
Yeah.
Well, it might bore you to tears.
No, I don't think so. No, it's a privilege, and thank you. That's all I can say for giving us your time and talking about your experience.
Good. Thank you.